Cedar Park, Texas, live. It's Timberwolf Night in America. This is the Vype Live Network, and tonight more nonstop honking of the Cedar Park football horn. I'm the V of the T, voice of the Timberwolves, Brad Cohn. It's our third show of the season, 110th show overall in 8-plus seasons. We're live from Santa Catarina Mexican Restaurant on Cypress Creek Road, a few hundred yards west of Old 183. We'll be here until 9 o'clock, so come on down and join us. We moved here because the previous venue wouldn't allow us to use a crowd speaker so that those who've gathered at the tables nearest can hear the show. Santa Catarina has said yes to that. And tonight we've got that speaker engaged for those joining us out on the patio here. With me tonight, as always, the king of Laces Out, the former wideout, a member of our 2010 district championship team and regional finalist. He lives vicariously through himself. The Holy Grail is looking for him. Lifetime Timberwolf Josh Willard.
Thank you so much for that formal introduction, and it feels great to be here discussing Timberwolf football after a great Timberwolf victory. And just excited to, again, be back in the mix. Timberwolf Night America, we're able to have our speaker and just have a lot of fun here on the patio at Santa Catarina. So thank you so much.
And Josh Cargyle is our quality assurance agent tonight, closely and diligently monitoring the broadcast from the super secret, high-tech, low-maintenance, ultra-modern, technically advanced, stealthily cloaked Vype Studios, making sure we don't sound like a great white shark gargling your leg. With us tonight, the Cedar Park running backs and their coach Lanny Williams. We'll be having an extensive conversation with them this evening, starting at the top of the hour. Remember, we'll do this show every week in which we have a game. We don't have a game next week, so next Tuesday night there will be no Timberwolf Night in America, but 2 weeks from tonight we'll be back with the linebackers. This year's Booster Club sponsors and the sponsors of this broadcast, Toyota of Cedar Park, HEB, Rudy's Barbecue, Mungia Real Estate, Army Ant Moving, our touchdown sponsor, TJ Lewis Real Estate. It felt good to call that out a few times last week.
Absolutely.
Alzer's Barbecue, Wofford Bank, and this here Santa Catarina Mexican Restaurant. So here's what's on the menu for tonight's show. First, Josh will do the state of the program update. We'll review the terrific performance against Cedar Ridge. Then a look at other scores of interest, including the other 11 5A teams. We'll take a trip through the wonderful world of Willard. Then at the top of the hour, bring on the running backs. We'll take a look at the season stats now that they've started accumulating. Then we'll play a new trivia game with the guys called Josh Willard.
Oh,
right
gosh.
Or wrong? And in closing, of course, a preview of Round Rock. So let's get going. Here's Josh with our latest state of the program update.
The all-time record for Cedar Park football is now 203-72. That's 131 games over 500. They're now 55-28 in regular season non-district games. And the program is now 96-26 in home games.
Woo!
70 games over 500. Cedar Park's record while playing as a top 10 ranked team is now 93-16. And against 6A teams while playing as a 5A team, Cedar Park is 26-8.
Wow.
Oh my goodness. The Timberwolves have won 7 of their last 8 non-district games, all of them against 6A teams. And they lead the all-time series with Cedar Ridge Raiders 3-1. And their 22-point margin over the Raiders Friday night is their largest of those wins. Kind of mind-boggling.
Yeah.
Now they are riding an 18-game winning streak at the Gup in the stadium in which they've gone 62-4 since its grand opening in 2010. And I can say, Brad, that my senior team did not lose one of those.
Yeah, none of those four was your senior team.
They didn't come from us in the opening season of the Gup.
That's right. All right, a quick trivia question out of the gate for you, Josh. In the Cedar Park record book, our highest passing yards average per game over one season of play was set last year with Ryder Hernandez, 323.7 a game. Second is his 238.3 the year before. Third is Max Sexton's 220.1 in 2017. Who's fourth?
Okay. Highest passing yards average per game over one season?
Yeah.
Let's just throw Pell in there for that amazing performance last week.
You got it. He
yes.
is fourth right now
yeah.
at 220 and change over the two games of this season. Pretty impressive.
Absolutely.
Pretty impressive. All right, the Cedar Ridge Review. It was homecoming. The Timberwolves did not disappoint the many graduates in the crowd. Two of my descendants were there, by the way, taking the lead, never relinquishing it. with a 29-7 throttling of the improperly named Cedar Ridge Raiders. We'll get to that later. Josh Pell cut through the Raider pass defense like a chainsaw through shaving cream, going 17 for 27 for 296 yards and two touchdowns. Nick Grulon had his introduction to the local press with 11 catches for 175 yards and a score. The Black Rain defense held Cedar Ridge to just 78 yards passing on 9 for 27 with one pick by Luke Kuharski and four sacks. Kevin Adams made his first start of the season at running back, logged 18 carries for 66 tough yards with a long run of 17. One of the very few downers on the night was that one of our punts was blocked and returned down inside the 5 for a Raider first and goal, but that led to a huge moment, perhaps a season-changing moment. Cedar Parks lead at the time, only 10-7, and they were staring at losing that lead, but four straight stops of Cedar Ridge's excellent running back, Giovanni Perry, turned the Raiders away. That classic goal line stand was a huge factor in this win. After the two teams punted at each other to start the game, CP went on a nice drive, but stalled at the 15. Raylon Barr came on, knocked through a 32-yarder to go up 3-0 with 3:48 left in the first. That was the first time Cedar Park has held a lead since the state semifinal ended in a 61-28 win over Corpus Christi Veterans Memorial last season. Less than a minute later, the Black Rain upped the margin when linebacker Reed Vines grabbed a loose ball after a sack of Aiden Liston and raced into the end zone with a 20-yard scoop and score. One of my favorite football terms, scoop and score, especially when we get to talk about our guys doing it. Barr's kick made it 10-0 with 2:59 to go in the first. Ridge then put together their only notable drive of the night, and Perry went in from 3 yards out. The kick made it 10-7, and that's where it stood at halftime, during which tight end Grant Nichols was named homecoming king. Nothing good happened for Cedar Ridge in the second half. In fact, Cedar Park didn't do much either until the fourth quarter, into which they went with the game still tight at 10-7. But that fourth quarter turned into an offensive tour de force. If there's any doubt that the hard work this team does, conditioning under Yancey Culp, makes a difference, Friday night should prove that out for you. Cedar Ridge got worn down by a physically superior Cedar Park team. They were gassed. The Timberwolves struck for three touchdowns in the fourth quarter and ran away with a game that was just a three-point margin going into the last 10 minutes. The first touchdown came on a 4-yard run by Adams. Unfortunately, that extra point play went haywire and the score was 16-7. The next touchdown came just 2 minutes later. 65-yard pass and run from Pell to Joseph Edwards. That was Edwards' first career touchdown. This PAT kick was routine, and the T-Wolves led 23-7. The final touchdown came just 3 minutes later on a 35-yard strike down the right sideline to Nick Grulon, which was also his first career touchdown catch. This kick failed as well, though, setting the final margin at 29-7. Cedar Park scored three touchdowns on three straight possessions, spanning only 4 minutes and 58 seconds on the clock. Most impressive when you can do that with the game on the line. It went from a close game to a rout in less than 5 minutes. Kind of like the Battle of Midway for you history buffs. And during the whole fourth quarter, the Black Rain let Cedar Ridge go nowhere. And talk about ending strong. This isn't any sort of official stat I keep, but if I did, I'm sure it would be a program record. In Josh Pell's last three passes of the night, all right, listen to this one. This is the one I was telling you about. In his last three passes of the night, he went 3 for 3 for 160 yards and two touchdowns. Now, we've had some pretty good quarterbacks here over the years. Nathan Thornhill, Brian Hogan, Nate Grimm, Max Sexton, Ryder Hernandez. None of those guys ever did anything like this. But to keep ourselves from being over-ebullient, on the negative side, we had a punt block, two bad punt snaps, two failed extra point plays, and no offensive touchdowns until the fourth quarter. On the positive side, a nice final margin over a good, solid 6A team. Terrific late-game performance on both sides of the ball. Almost 400 yards of total offense with greatly reduced turnovers and critical penalties. Going into this game, there are so many things that needed to improve, and true to the old football adage that your biggest improvement comes between Game 1 and Game 2, nearly all the things that went so wrong against Vandegrift got righted against Vista Ridge. Here are nine of them. After nine punts in the opener, only five this week. After five turnovers in the opener, only two this week. After never leading in the opener, never trailing this week. After dozens of missed tackles in the opener, very few this week. After Vandy got almost 500 yards on 69 plays in the opener, Cedar Ridge got only 195 on the same amount of plays, 69, this week. Gave up 6.88 yards per snap last week, only 2.83 this week, a better than 4 yard per play improvement for the Black Rain. After we got only 250 yards on 69 plays in the opener, we got 392 on 10 fewer plays this week. That's 3.62 yards per snap last week, 6.64 yards per snap this week, almost doubling it. After leaving receivers completely uncovered on 4 of Vandy's 5 touchdown passes in the opener, no touchdown passes allowed this week, and Ridge completed only 9 of 27 with a pick. At least 5 Ridge passes were tipped by defenders at the line. After getting 0 sacks for the first time in 4 years in the opener, there were 4 sacks against Cedar Ridge. After 21 of 69 plays went for 1 yard or less for Vandy in the opener, it was 31 of 69 for Cedar Ridge at 1 yard or less this week, a 50% increase for the Black Rain. After only 3 Vandegrift plays lost yardage in the opener, 9 Cedar Ridge plays lost yardage this week, a 200% increase for the Black Rain. Lots to be impressed with when thinking about the difference in Cedar Park's quality of play across a large number of categories between Game 1 and Game 2. But we got to keep in mind something that Chris Ross always told us, Josh. You're never as bad as you think you are when you lose, and you're never as good as you think you are when you win.
Yeah, but still, I'm taking this win and taking it to the bank because this is definitely how you want to respond after losing that opening week to Vandegrift. You wanted to see all these, you know, questions get answered for the Cedar Park team, and that's what they did offensively. They were able to minimize those turnovers, minimize those crucial penalties, and able to produce drives that ended in touchdowns, not necessarily field goals. It was so satisfying to see this running back unit get into the end zone on a tough earned drive that really needed this rushing attack to finish, and that's exactly what they did. And then you saw the big explosive plays as well through Josh Pell, Nick Grulon, Mr. Edwards, yes, number 8. Spectacular catch. You still have more receiving yards already through your career than I do, and I played, We'll get into that whenever we had the wideouts.
I got more receiving yards than you do.
It's okay. I'm the king of laces out. That's why they still call me that. You know, it's okay that Cole Kruger claims that he's the best holder. It's not going to stand. But still, nonetheless, very proud of the Cedar Park team for coming out and just playing good Cedar Park football. I can tell you, and we'll get into it in the Willard of Oz segment, everybody in the stadium when Cedar Ridge got that opportunity at the goal line on the 3 yard line, everybody wrote off a touchdown except for the Black Rain. That was impressive. That was a season changing moment.
I think
whenever
so.
You start the championship DVD, that's the segment that you look at, and it was so powerful to see that team come through, and then to see the offense follow through with big plays, big explosive plays to keep the momentum on their side that ended up putting points on the board.
Here's some of the stats. First down 16-9 in favor of us. Total offense 392 to 195, almost 200 yards more offense than they had. Individual stats in the running game, we got the running backs tonight. Kevin Adams 18 for 66, including a 4 yard touchdown. Pell ran twice for 3. Mundell 3 for 15. Tyree Nicholson 8 for 17. Receiving, only 4 guys caught passes. One of our lowest numbers in a long time, but
yeah,
it was still 296 yards, a 17.41 yards per catch average across the team. Tyree had 1 for 5. Carter Well had 3 for 37. Joseph Edwards 2 for 79, including that 65-yard score. And Nick Grulon 11 for 175, a 15.9 average, a 35-yard touchdown, and another that went 60 yards.
Yeah, and a coming out game for Nick Grulon for sure. And the limited amount of wideouts is just a credit to this stable of running backs that we have at Cedar Park. Their ability to keep pounding that running game and to opening up the passing lanes just because of their willingness to pound the rock. It's so exciting to see how this team is maneuvering through the season, coming off of that week one loss and now off of this victory. And you still got a big opponent coming into next week. This is still a 6A deep 6A team in Round Rock, and you gotta put these successes quickly behind you and regroup and learn how to game plan for this next opponent. So it's going to be really exciting to see how the Cedar Park team navigates through the season.
Hey, look over here what Craig Weems ordered for all of us.
Holy
Thanks
cow!
A lot, Craig. That looks pretty good.
I got kind of sidetracked right
looking
there.
Looking at me like I'm an idiot.
Santa Kansas Arena,
I
come
am,
on.
But he doesn't have to look at me like I'm an idiot. All right, some observations while updating the school record book, which I maintain. Josh Pell's 299 yards of total offense against Cedar Ridge, the 34th most for an individual in one game in program history. Now, remember, we got to set this little benchmark out every year. When we say something is the 34th best in program history, something like total offense, well, there's 7, 8, 10 guys putting total offense in a game numbers together for every game, and we've played 275 games. So if you're 34th best ever like this, that's out of around 2,500 entries.
Yeah, it's unbelievable.
34th out of 2,500 is pretty good. So even numbers like 34th, it's not 34th out of 37. So, you know, remember that when we go through there. Pell's 296 passing yards, 22nd most, 275 games. Now with 1,081 career rushing yards, Kevin Adams moves up to 14th on the all-time list at Cedar Park, just behind Ethan Fry and Thomas Hutchings, just ahead of Jav Guidry.
Ooh, Jav Guidry getting the star with the New York Jets.
Yeah. The 11, and he's ahead of him. There you go, Kevin. There's a guy playing for the Jets that you have rushed for more yards than at the same high school. There you go. The 11 catches by Nick Grulon tie two other performances for third most ever in one game in Cedar Park history, behind only the 12 catches by Josh Cameron against Friendswood in the 19 playoffs. Coach remembers that one. NRG Stadium. And the 14 by Carson Neal, also against Cedar Ridge in 2019. Grulon's 212 career receiving yards amassed in just two games is already the 45th most in Cedar Park history. He's going to climb that ladder quick.
Chill, Grulon. Come on now.
Grulon's 125 yards, sixth most ever in one game by a Cedar Park receiver.
Sixth?
Sixth most ever in one game. Grulon's 111 receiving yards in the second half is the fifth most in one half at Cedar Park ever. Joseph Edwards' 79 receiving yards was the 66th best in Cedar Park history. Grulon and Edwards both had their first career touchdown catches in this game. They are the 82nd and 83rd players ever to catch a touchdown pass for Cedar Park. 296 team passing yards, the 23rd best ever in program history. 275 games. It's in the top 10 percentile. The 195 a total offense allowed Cedar Ridge was the 28th lowest total by a Cedar Park defense in 275 games. So again, top 10 percentile. The 57 total yards allowed in the second half is the 35th fewest ever, tied with what was allowed Lancaster in the 2012 state championship game. I didn't remember that until I looked it up. Lancaster only got 57 yards against us in the second half of that state championship.
Yeah, that hurts.
Woo! The 78 yards passing allowed Ridge, 35 best in program's defensive history. This was the 78th time in Cedar Park's 275-game football history that the opponent was held to a single-digit point total. Cedar Park is 77-1 in those games. The victory or defeat trend line on the scoreboard for Cedar Park historically is 20. They are 184-23 all-time when scoring 20 points or more in a game. They are 143-10 all-time when allowing less than 20 points in a game. They're now 134-3 when scoring 28 points or more in regular season games. And we are now 62-4 at the Gup.
Wow.
This win keeps alive an 18-game home winning streak that stretches back to 2018.
62-4 at the Gup is insane. That's how you protect the house. And just a great overall performance from the trenches to big explosive plays to also just making things happen on the defensive side of the ball. Just very excited how the Cedar Park Timberwolves came out, put that last loss behind them, and just seeing these, you know, guys making their footmarks in the record books, it's exciting to see how fast they could climb because there's still a lot of football left in the season.
Right, and as the keeper of the record book, each Saturday morning when I'm updating it, going through it, it's like 179 pages long. Putting new names in spots is always really fulfilling. It's really good. All right, here's a look at District 11 5A D1 this last Friday night. Of course, we beat Cedar Ridge 29-7. Anderson fell to Rouse 57-54. I think they're playing touch football.
Wow.
No defense allowed in that one.
Don't tell Coach Mann that.
Georgetown over Copperas Cove 63-39. 102 points scored in that one.
Interesting.
111 in the Anderson Rouse game. Nobody's allowed to play defense, I guess, except us. And maybe Maynard. They beat Bastrop by the same score we beat Ridge, 29-7. Pflugerville over McNeil, 51-21.
2-0.
Weiss over Glenn, 49-21. Leander fell to Vista Ridge on TV Thursday night. I watched that game. 23-21, Leander can't throw the football.
Hey, kept him on the ropes, though.
I started watching with probably 8 minutes left in the second quarter. And in their last possession of the game, they completed the first pass with my eyes on the TV. They completed one more. They're both out in the flat. They're down trying to move the ball.
Who does that say more about?
Then they went over three the rest of the way and ended the game with a pick.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we got to remember that. We're game plan for them. They don't throw the ball. All right, and then Hendrickson fell to Killeen 22-17. Leander and Pflugerville, the only 11-5A teams to win their openers, but this week, Cedar Park, Georgetown, Maynard, Pflugerville, Weiss all won. Leander, Anderson, and Hendrickson fell, so the district now 7-9 on the season. Here are the current records of 11-5A teams and their next opponents. Pflugerville's on top at 2-0. Anderson and Hendrickson on the bottom at 0-2. Everybody else in between at 1-1. Pflugerville's next game, they're hosting 0-2 Glenn at the Pfluger Bowl.
Let's take the Panthers.
Yeah. Cedar Park is hosting 2-0 Round Rock. That's a tough one. They are running up scores on people. That's going to be a challenge. Georgetown 1-1, Liberty Hill 1-1.
That's going to be a good game.
Good game. Leander takes their 1-1 mark to 0-2 Cedar Creek, Bastrop's second school. I'm going to pick Leander in that one, actually.
Yep.
Maynard at Fulshear, which is down about 15 miles southeast of Katy. Maynard, they're 1-1. Fulshear's 2-0. Might be tough. Weiss is 1-1, but strong. They are at 1-1 Westwood. They're equally. That's going to be a good game. That's going to be a good one to see at the Farmer Palace. Anderson's 0-2. They host Rouse, I think, at Nelson Field. Rouse is 2-0. Josh Mann's got them playing well.
Didn't they just play Rouse?
Rouse is going to beat them, I think. Did they just play them? Maybe I got the schedule wrong there. I think you're right. Let me see.
We'll have to fact check that one later.
Nope. Anderson and Rouse. Yep. I got that one wrong. So I'm not sure who Anderson plays. We'll have to check that one later. Hendrickson is 0-2. They are at 1-1 Belton. Good catch, Josh. All right. Now let's take a look at some other scores of interest from last week. Port Arthur Memorial 56, Barbers Hill 28. What's going on with Carl?
Just give him time. Just give the man time to work.
Giving up a lot of points in both games. Started 0-2. Denton Geyer, 14. Denton Ryan, 7. How did that happen?
Don't care. Glad it happened. Denton Ryan.
Gosh. Dripping Springs, 70. Hayes, 42. That's not a basketball score.
Yeah, the Tigers are really running up scores over there.
Tyler Legacy, used to be Tyler Lee, 62. Tyler John Tyler, 55. Another basketball score, no defense allowed. But Joe Willis' team now 2-0.
Sudden change. Coach Willis taking the district.
Lovejoy, 71. Sulphur Springs, 7. Chris Ross' team now 2-0. And both times run up a lot of points.
We don't care about what other teams are going to do. We only care about ourselves and converting points.
That's right. A good Chris Ross quote. Chris Ross quote. Mount Vernon, 38. Pittsburgh, 6. That's not the Steelers. Pittsburgh, Texas. Brad Willard's team now 2-0. That name's familiar.
Yeah, I'm telling you, my brother is actually just kind of implementing that Chris Ross mentality. Run up the score. Don't leave any room for hope. Good job, Tigers.
Beat your opponent hopeless.
Just like he did me as a little kid.
Yeah! How many times did he throw you down the stairs?
We don't want to need to get into that.
All right. Austin Bowie, 38. Stony Point, 7. Westwood, 42. Austin High, 27. Vandegrift, 31. Killeen Ellison, 14. Westlake, 34. Euless Trinity, storied program there, 14.
That's a great non-district home game to get for Westlake.
Yeah. Round Rock, 35. Belton, nothing. Belton's good. So our next opponent looking awfully good. Lake Travis, 52. Converse, Judson, 20. Judson's good.
Yeah,
Lake
huge, Travis that was a good. Huge win for Lake Travis.
They don't even have Hudson Card quarterbacking. The Horns got him. Liberty Hill, 62. Del Valle, or hopeless Del Valle, 6, I guess. There's a little hopeless.
I mean,
game.
Liberty Hill, that was just flat out embarrassing what you did to the Cardinals at their turf.
How did they lose 12-7 last week? They must have had guys sick or something. Hutto, 27, Waco High, 14. Harker Heights, 62, Eastview, 7. Lampasas, 56, Elgin, 13. And the huge old Hill Country rivalry, Fredericksburg, 44, Kerrville, Tyvee, 27. The Battling Billy Goats.
The Battling Billy Goats get it done against the alma mater of Johnny Manziel.
Johnny Manziel, Johnny Football. All right, now it's off to see the Willard, the wonderful Willard of Oz. Here we go on another fascinating voyage through the wonderful world of Willard. Oh. Josh What do you want to do? You want to just vocal it? Or?
We're going to vocal. No. Okay. We don't need to give anybody that acapella. We're not going to do anybody that due diligence. So we'll just go ahead and get right into it really quickly. Some great college football scores coming out to start the college football weekend. We had that opening weekend, but really this was the full slate of college football and a crazy game in FCS, and it was Presbyterian won 84-43.
How many threes did they hit?
Well, Presbyterian's quarterback went 38 for 50, 538 yards, 10 touchdowns.
Who's he think he is, Ryder Hernandez?
Unbelievable. 10 touchdowns, 10.8 average yards per attempt.
Golly.
Just an unbelievable stat to go ahead and throw out there week one. Just hope you can live up to that hype the rest of the season. And then also, the same night as Cedar Park got the win against the Cedar Ridge Raiders, Kansas finally broke a 13-game losing streak by beating FCS South Dakota State. And the students that were there, actually in attendance, stormed the field.
Oh, well, yeah.
Well, that's okay. You got to let them have that.
Rock, jock, Jayhawk.
Absolutely.
And stole their fight song.
And then finally, we're going to preview the stupid as the stupid does, but just simply a great game between Notre Dame and Florida State on Sunday night. It was the standalone game since NFL doesn't play any games this week, and it was wild with the backup quarterback for Florida State, Mildred, having a comeback game of the century. A three-year starter at UCF had a horrific life-threatening leg injury, and that caused him to pause his collegiate career for 3 years.
Wow.
And then through rehab and grit, he earned a backup spot at Florida State. His number was called during a Sunday night game, and he completed a crucial third down, put together a nice touchdown drive to help them solidify that overtime chance to take down Notre Dame at the beginning of the year.
Wow.
And just a great comeback performance for Mildred. And then finally, we've got to give it to a great performance on the Stupid as a Stupid Does. It's just these late or post-game interviews that these sideline reporters get with coaches or players that are in the moment.
Yeah,
some people think
all
they're
emotional.
Some people think they're comedians. Some people are not. And Brian Kelly's comedic timing on this one is just absolutely terrible. No, Florida State had him on the ropes, took him to overtime, should have beat Notre Dame. But Notre Dame ended up coming with the win, and Notre Dame, Brian Kelly's head coach, got this interview at the very end.
This game had it all.
Yeah.
What did you think of your team's ability to withstand Florida State's impressive comeback?
Yeah, I'm in favor of execution. Maybe our entire team needs to be executed after.
Ba-dum-bum.
Oh, maybe our entire team needs to be executed. You could see in his face halfway through that when he explains that he's in favor of execution. He's like, my eyes got really wide in the headlights of deers. This is not going to play. So that's why you get featured on Timberwolf Night in America.
Are you stupid or something?
I'm as stupid as a stupid does.
It certainly is. Now, I caught that UCF game. Was that Sunday night, right?
It was Sunday night.
And UCF's an up-and-coming program. They still got a little ways to go. They've got a little bit of small-townishness in them because I heard in the background of the broadcast their announcer doing something that is considered the hokiest of all small-town hokiisms. And you know where I'm headed.
Okay.
And that is his team, Central Florida, gets 7 yards, and it's good for first down. And so he'll say, 7 yards on the carry by whoever, Kevin Adams. And that's good for a Central Florida. And the crowd yells, first down. Absolute small town hokeyism. Georgetown does that. Other schools do that. And I thought of something I would love to do, but I'm not going to do because it's too cruel. I would love to, the next time the Georgetown Eagles gain 3 on 3rd and 7, to say that 3-yard gain sets up another Georgetown. And our crowd yells, fourth down. I would love to do that. But that's rubbing it in, so I won't do it.
Yeah, we would hate to say it, but yeah. we would just hate to say it.
Yeah, we're thinking. All right, we're going to take a short break. When we return, our guests, the running backs and their coach, Lanny Williams. Stick around. You're listening to Timberwolf Night in America live from Santa Catarina right here on the Vype Live Network.
Experience the difference at Toyota of Cedar Park, one of the Austin area's newest automobile dealerships. Their new vehicle department will always stock the newest Toyota models you need. The pre-owned vehicles they choose must each pass a rigorous inspection and be in tip-top shape before they make it to their lot or website for you to see. And if you're looking for budget-friendly Toyota-certified used vehicles, they've got you covered, and you can rest easy knowing that the best new cars make the best used cars. That's Toyota of Cedar Park at toyotaofcedarpark.com.
A premier real estate brokerage in Central Texas, Mungia Real Estate's innovative buy-sell process results in their listings selling faster than the Austin average. Their attention to clients sets Mungia apart from other brokerages. With creative marketing strategies, savvy negotiation skills, and a commitment to hard work and excellent customer service. Whether it's residential, single-family, multifamily, condos, commercial, or vacant land, Mungia Real Estate knows the Austin market and connects buyers with sellers every day. And they do it with professionalism. Mungia Real Estate at 512-922-4267 or mungiarealestate.com. That's M-U-N-G-I-A.
In the battle for barbecue supremacy, Warriors pit prime meats, secret sauces, and recipes against one another. Yet one champion stands alone. Rudy's Country Store and Barbecue, in the modern-day vernacular, where bad means good. Rudy's Country Store and Barbecue has the worst barbecue in Texas.
You know the Alzer family. They've been involved in Cedar Park sports for years, just as Alzer's Barbecue has been involved in Cedar Park cuisine for years. It's one-of-a-kind, authentic Texas barbecue. Brisket, turkey, chicken, lamb, terrific sides and sauces. It's sheer succulence. That's Alzer's Barbecue, next to the Shell station on 1431, just east of Lakeline. Open Friday through Sunday, every weekend.
Okay, welcome back. Episode 3 of Timberwolf Night in America for 2021, live from Santa Catarina on Cypress Creek Road here in Cedar Park. I'm Brad Cohn, joined by Josh Willard, Josh Cargyle, our QA tonight here on the Vype Live Network. And now, our special guest tonight, the running backs and their coach, Lanny Williams. We'll start with Coach Williams in his third year at Cedar Park, and he just gave us a tidbit of information that we're glad to have and tell everybody what that is, and we have to admit a mea culpa here.
I heard it Friday during the game. Y'all were saying Nick Grulon, and I'm like, man, I don't know if Brad knows. I think in the L's run together, it's supposed to be Nick Grulon.
Kind of a New Orleans pronunciation.
Yeah, it's got
I'm gonna go hand up. That's my fault right here.
I knew that Nick's parents would really appreciate that. Since I'm here tonight, I'm thinking, what a better time to like tell you guys.
We'll do it.
We're just trying to capitalize. We want to make sure it's right. I'm from North Carolina. I can't read right.
There you go.
From now on, it's Nick Grulon, right?
Oh Lord.
That's probably one you get, right? Grulon. 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 I think I was calling you Grulon. Grulon, okay. All right, Coach, we're going to talk football for a great bit of this segment, but I want to start with baseball.
Okay.
I am so glad. When the coaches changed, I thought, oh, no, I hope Lanny Williams don't go with him because we've got to find another good baseball coach. I don't know if we can find one that good. You've done such a great job with Cedar Park baseball. Really revived that program. It wasn't really down, but you've taken it to another level. And how soon do you get to start on that? Is it like the day after our last football game, are you over there?
Not over it. Am I over the season? Is that
I mean,
you
are
mean?
You over there at baseball?
Oh yeah, we are. Stuff. Yeah, we're working out. We since school started, first day of school, been back at it again. Today we were on the field and we start our fall league tomorrow. As a matter of fact, we play Round Rock in a live action scrimmage, baseball scrimmage. So we'll scrimmage for the next 6 weeks with our guys. So I'm excited about them.
What time and where is that?
5:30 at Cedar Park.
Oh, wow.
So we'll do the first 2 weeks are tomorrow and next Wednesday. I think it's Round Rock and Georgetown. And then after that, we go Liberty Hill. Then we're back at home again against Vista. Then Liberty Hill and I think Georgetown again. So just six games just to look at our guys and kind of see what we have coming and just kind of get excited about our season and getting a good feel for the guys.
You know, last year you had a great team, one of the best, maybe the best we've had since – we had a state tournament team 20 years ago that played at the Dish. But Yeah, it ran into a little bit of unfortunacy in that there wasn't anybody going to beat us twice.
Yeah.
We lost a coin flip and had to have a one-game series against Rouse, and that really cost us that series. They weren't going to beat us twice.
Yeah, and that was frustrating, and I understand. I get it.
Yeah.
I just thought it was ironic that they didn't play anyone else one game the rest of the way, and then they picked us at that one time. And he told me, he's like, we can't beat you twice.
Oh, we're going to take our chance.
Take our chance, and you guys not playing well. And kudos to them. They did a great job. And
they went all the way to the state tournament
with
it. So, of course, that's where we would have
been.
Yeah,
exactly. And that hurts, you know, but it is what it is. And that's part of athletics and just part of the system and the way the rules, you know, follow.
I hear you got some great pitching going on right now.
We do. We got some pretty good arms. Some guys I'm excited about. Adam is doing well. Louis Alonso's doing well. I had a great summer. Some young guys, some guys that are coming in. The guys on the JV, Ethan Becker, who plays football for us. Quentin Mudlin, who also plays. Actually, he's not playing football this year. Had another great year. And Gavin Bernard, who's also a football player as well. And then there's some young guys that we're really excited about. Kay Davis is a sophomore lefty, and just a group of seniors also that you know, they want to be given the chance to play and see how well they can do, and we're excited about those guys as well. But having Julian back and Adam back and Alonzo back makes a pretty good solid foundation for our program. We just got to build some guys around them.
All right. We took that short detour to baseball because this man is a terrific baseball coach and talks baseball well, and I know it's a passion of his and mine too, so we want to go there for a minute. But let's turn to football now.
Absolutely.
Got the running backs here tonight. They're under your tutelage. What is the toughest thing to do as a coach to get these running backs in the shape and in the mindset that you want them to be to run the football for Cedar Park?
I think if Kevin – today we have Kevin and Tyree here with us. Mundell's feeling under the weather. But I think the toughest thing is to – during the practice week, and I think that Kevin and Tyree would definitely attest to this, is getting the tough reps against the Black Rain defense and not getting hurt. Because we want the guys who have some – and we talk about, you know, hey, today during inside run, Kevin, you're going to get two carries. Tyree, you're going to get two and get you guys out of there. Because we've seen both times where Kevin has got banged up during inside run. Tyree came out. He was going to start well against us. And then Monday – last year as a sophomore, he got banged up during defense inside run. So there's a fine line with that.
Yeah.
They're talented. We know they're talented with what they do and how well they do it. It's just that you do want those guys to have the contact but also not get hurt in the process of running. And you have to run hard, but the defense, you know, Kevin's hard to tackle, Tyree's hard to tackle, and so they get amped up for them. So you just, as a coach, you have to be careful and not let the competitive – nature of me or them overtake what the end result is. The end result is get them to Friday so they can perform on Friday, and they've done well when they have. Kevin missed the first game because of he was banged up in practice,
and I was
pretty frustrated with that. But it happens. It is what it is. But that's probably the hardest part about the running backs.
And part of that is that both of these guys are physical runners. They don't shy away from the contact.
Yeah.
So as they're delivering blows, they take half of that kinetic energy themselves too. But it is, for me, I like physical football myself. I was a running back in junior high, and I turned to defensive back in high school because I want to be the guy doling out the punishment more than taking it. But it's very fulfilling emotionally, psychologically for me to see tough running backs going between the tackles and knocking into people. I love watching both of you guys run.
Yeah, and they run hard. I mean, during the game Friday night, there was a situation. We talked to them. I look at these guys as kind of like the closer in baseball. When the game is, we're going to win the game, they're going to put the ball in your hands. Your main thing is not let go of the ball, to not give the ball up. So we're not going to pass it. They're going to give it to you. And so make sure that you are the closer, and also the situations where we do have to be tough and not give it up. Third and short, we know that we have to be downhill runners. You mentioned the stop that the defense had against Cedar Ridge, and right before Kevin went out, I was like, Kevin, this is not a dance around time right now. And, you know, he already knew the situation. I was like, we have to get it and hit it downhill and try to get as many yards as we can, so we're not backed up with punting. And sure enough, his first run, he gashed him, and then he gashed him again and then gashed him again. So he did his job, and so proud of him. But he works that way, and it doesn't surprise me. And he knew going into it, Coach, I got it. You know, Kevin's, you know, Kevin and I have been together now for, this is our third year together. Right, so he knows me. I know him. And we have a great relationship. When talking, he can come with me with anything when it comes to things like that. So I'm just proud of him. But more importantly, they have to understand, you know, the situation of the game. There's times that you want to make plays. There's times we got to get the ball downhill and get us out of a jam, and they do a great job of that.
I like the fact that both of these guys, they take the ball and immediately they're just going, whether they're hole or not, they're going.
Yeah.
You know, we had an issue with a couple of running backs over the last few years where they'd take the ball and the first thing they do is, and we think, well, it's over. It's over right there.
Right.
That's
right.
All the time they need to plug whatever hole to get to you. It's you're not going anywhere when you do this.
Right.
The first thing you get out. These guys don't do that, and I love that about them.
Well, and I think, too, that, I mean, with Kevin and Gavin being seniors, Tyree being a junior, you have a collective group that's got a lot of experience, a lot of, you know, miles on the engine, per se, and talk about this group collectively and just how accountable they are to do their job day in and day out.
I think more important than anything, they hold each other, they're accountable to each other, and they all bring something different to the table. Kevin's very powerful. You look at him; I mean, he looks tremendous in his uniform. Very, very good. So you know what you're going to get from Kevin. Kevin's gonna beat you up, you know, on the tackle. He knows that, and he tries to be shifty at times. We talk about that. Kevin just run downhill, you know, but he has that in him because that's how he was. I'm assuming at the junior high level that way, but here. You know, there was a play that Kevin had an opportunity to make a move on a safety and get more downfield, and he ran outside, and we talked about that. Just, man, just get your yards, get him as he can, because eventually you running through that safety might set you up for something else later on. Tyree's different. Tyree goes and finds contact. Like, he'll go running to somebody. It's just like
– He's often running. And that's
the way he is, and that's great because I know that – if Kevin is not playing, Tyree's going to – we don't skip a beat with Tyree if Kevin isn't there. It's not that we don't want Kevin to be there, but we know that having these two guys are the same. Mundell's a little bit different. He's shifty. Powerful also, but Mundell's kind of like what I would call a home run hitter. He can – when he's healthy, he can outrun anybody. He can run away from people, which is pretty good, and we've seen him do that a lot last year. So,
yeah.
Those three guys pretty much complement each other, and
those are the only three, right? Those are the only three.
Yeah, we decided to go with three. We felt like that, man. Getting four in the mix. We had four the first year. Last year we had four.
Three.
UK and Mundell. Yeah, last year we had three, so it worked out perfect.
Yeah, not enough carries for four.
Yeah, it's not, man. Right, and they're on the varsity, and I don't like necessarily having like a guy to be a mop-up guy. I want the guys to all be in the game. So if you notice that Tyree, Kevin will start. Tyree's probably going to play the second or third series. Mundell may get a series there at the end of the first half. And then
Spread out the contact.
The game is where we're going to win, we take Kevin out, let Tyree and Mundell finish it off. So it's been great. But I love talking with Kevin. You know, we were worried last week with Kevin just – And I kind of put it in his hands. I was like, okay, here's the deal. You need to tell me how you feel about things. Can you go? Can you not go? I want to put this in your situation. I want you to think about it, pray about it, and just tell me tomorrow how you feel. And he says, Coach, I want to go until I can't go anymore. And I'm like, great.
Holy cow.
We'll do. So I'm like, good.
Oh, Lord.
Of course, he ate Chicken Express before the game. So I think we found that a couple of times on the sideline. But he gives you all these guys. And, man, I'm just so proud of him and what he does, the leadership he has. And one of the things that a lot of people don't know about Kevin is such a team player. During the Vandegrift game, I mean, we're frustrated the kids aren't doing well, and there's one guy on the sideline who isn't playing, who is just the whole entire time trying to get the sideline up, trying to get the guys motivated, telling the guys keep their heads up. And after the ball game, his voice is as hoarse as all get out because he is so in tune to his teammates and wanted his teammates to do well. So he definitely exemplifies what I love as a coach out of a player. He gives that to us.
And that's a growth pattern demonstrated him, right? Because I think as a sophomore, he's a pretty quiet kid. He wasn't really demonstrative last year.
He was quiet.
Taking a leadership role as a senior.
He was quiet, but what you didn't see was at the San Angelo game. I don't know if Stockwell scored or Brock scored. And I don't know if you scored. I remember early in the season, someone scored, and Kevin is in the end zone celebrating with him. So you may not see that. You may not have saw it, you know, just from the outside looking
right.
in. But on the inside,
you see it.
You definitely see it all the time. He's that way. He's always picking the team up, picking guys up. He's one of our captains this year, and I'm so proud of him for that as well. But he's phenomenal. Just a great person.
You know, you talk about his power as a runner. That's certainly been demonstrated many times. But I've also noticed that when he gets, you know, a little bit of broken field opportunities and there's a guy ahead of him, he doesn't always just go for the guy to run him over like a bulldozer. He's got some sort of shifty, immediate 10-degree change that plays tricks on your eye. It's like a no-wasted motion change of direction that takes no time at all.
And
that looks good.
And Kevin plays a lot of 7-on-7 in the summertime. And I know there's a lot of footwork that he does and the different types of drills that he's doing. So his feet are very good, you know. So he's very shifty when it comes to that. So, you know, sometimes I like it because he can really set guys up to get kind of run over because they see the shift, so it makes him stop. But he could literally lower his shoulders and just go plow him over, and he's done that. He's a special back. I'm glad he's with us.
Yeah, me too. You know, Coach, we only have two guys here tonight. There's
right.
only a third that's missing, so not a lot of players. This is something we usually ask the players,
uh-huh.
a couple of questions, but I'm going to give them to you.
Okay.
Of your three running backs, which one's the funniest?
Oh, man, ooh. Probably this guy right here.
He's smiling.
This one right here. He's always, man, Kevin's sneaky funny, but Tyree is just, I mean, let me say this. Tyree thinks he's funny, but he's not. Let me say that.
And that's funny.
Would you agree with that?
He thinks he's funny.
He thinks he's funny, but he's not. So, but he's probably the one that probably has the most jokes. And I mean, he wants to do everything. Like, he wants to punt. He wants to deep snap. He wants to, like, hold kicks.
Yes.
He just. I'm like, Tyree, just be a running back. So, but he brings a lot of energy. But Tyree's probably the funniest out of all of them.
All right, next, who's the best singer?
The best singer?
Maybe nobody, huh?
I don't know. Kevin? Kevin or Gavin? We haven't heard him really sing. I haven't heard him sing. Maybe Kevin tonight is singing a song for us.
If he
is, yeah. I'll say Kevin.
Okay, Gavin. We'll get a chance to sing the national anthem.
There you go. There you go.
Who's the best dancer?
I'm going to say Kevin.
Kevin?
I'm going to definitely say Kevin. Tyree's from Oklahoma. They don't dance like
that. That's right.
That's right. I've seen Kevin out on the football field. I think Kevin has a lot of rhythm, so Kevin's probably the best dancer.
Okay, an important one. Cedar Park still implementing that early morning practice that started with my senior year. Who's the last one out ready
Kevin.
To go?
Kevin.
All right. We just got to clear that.
It's Kevin. Gavin shows up. It's Kevin. It just depends, but it's definitely Kevin. But I would say Kevin's the last one out, you know. But he's good though.
And the last one, who's the best liar?
Oh,
gosh, man, they.
This is the parent
liar?
Question.
I don't know, man. I mean, I don't.
You don't know.
Not lying to coach.
They must all be lying. Here's
the deal, right? Here's the deal, man. We really do have a good relationship. When it comes to stuff like that, I don't. I can't think.
I'm saying Tyree.
Tyree? Okay, we'll go with Tyree.
Throw the junior under the bus.
There you go.
They're good kids, man.
All right, there's Lanny Williams, our head baseball coach and our running backs coach now, and he's going to be in his third year for baseball, and he's in his third year for football. Now we got the mic in the hands of the senior running back named Kevin Adams, and Kevin. You had several great carries your sophomore year, and up in the booth we're broadcasting games, and who is this guy? This guy's going to be terrific. What is it you like best about being a running back for Cedar Park?
I really just like having the ball in my hands and feeling like I have an impact on what I'm doing with the team. and how the game is going.
Who's a role model for you as far as how they perform as a running back in college, pros, anything? What running back really gets your attention?
I'd have to say J.K. Dobbins.
Ooh.
Yeah,
I like J.K. Dobbins.
Moment of silence for getting hurt to now J.K. Dobbins, but...
We've talked about, you know, your running style, talked about your power and what you can do with contact, what you can do to avoid contact. Which would you prefer? There you are, running an open field. There's a guy 5 yards away just standing there. Do you want to run him over, or do you want to just put a move on him and go past him?
Because
it's a different question than what you actually do. What do you want to do?
What do I want to do? I want to run him over.
There you
go. Yeah, it's a football guy through
Me
and through.
Me too. But sometimes you go around him, right?
Yeah, sometimes.
Yeah, it depends if you think you're faster than he is or whatever.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly.
What's your best carry? Do you remember some carry that sticks in your mind as that was my best moment carrying the ball for Cedar Park?
My best carry.
The run last year where you dove and you jumped out of
bounds.
You dove at the goal line.
Oh, against Pflugerville?
Yes. Coach is suggesting one point.
That was the day game.
Yeah. The COVID game.
It was against Pflugerville on a Saturday.
Mm-hmm.
And we were running GT to the left. And I stiff-armed a guy, then ran down the sideline, and then jumped in for the end zone. That was my favorite one, for sure.
Are you from Cedar Park, or did you move here from somewhere? Where were you born? Where did you
I was born in California, but came here when I was, like, real young. So I've been here the whole time, really. This is all I know.
All through CP. School, at LISD schools. And,
So through elementary, came to elementary, middle school. Now I'm here.
So has it always been the offensive side of the ball? Have you ever played defense?
Growing up, I played both sides, but I just like offense way better.
We like to score touchdowns.
Exactly.
Come on.
Love touchdowns.
That's right.
When you're standing out there and the play gets set in, what play call is it that gets your spark plug fired up? You're ready for this snap. This is the play you like.
Favorite play.
And you don't have to give the actual code name of the play, 23 Stitch or something. Just kind of what the play does, what your role is on the play.
I like to be on the left hash, and if they call inside zone to the right, that's my favorite play right there.
Okay. Like running inside better than around the end?
Yes, I like inside running better.
Cool. Shorter steps to get more yards, right?
Exactly,
That's right. More chance to run somebody over, right?
Yes, sir.
So you're a senior. How are the grades going right now?
Real good, all A's.
Good. That's outstanding.
Yes, sir.
We often ask that, and it's often all A's. This is a great football program that knows how to do more than just play football. So what are your plans for post-high school? What do you want to do?
I want to go somewhere and study kinesiology. I don't know what college yet. I'm trying to still figure that one out. But I want to study kinesiology and then eventually become a athletic trainer, something in that range, something like that, yeah.
Replace David Bowman here, right?
Oh, Lord, he would love that. He would love that break.
any alma mater for one of your folks that might be, they're pushing on you or anything like that?
No, not really.
So anywhere that's got a good kinesiology school. Yeah. You know what degree our best running back in the history of Cedar Park with 4,555 yards and 57 career touchdowns has?
I don't.
Kinesiology.
That's Quentin? Degree.
Quentin Smith?
Quentin Smith
got a kinesiology and business management degrees simultaneously from Rice while he was becoming their second leading all-time rusher.
I'd do anything what he says.
Yeah. So you're following good footsteps, running the ball hard and tough, looking at kinesiologists like the Q.
Sir.
All right, there's Kevin Adams, our senior running back. Now we're going to give the mic to the other running back here, Tyree Nicholson. And Tyree, what's the nature of the name Tyree? Why'd your parents name you Tyree? That's a cool name.
Well, it was supposed to be Kyrie or like Devin, but my dad didn't really like him, so we just stuck with Tyree.
Put the T in there, right?
Yeah.
Now, where were you born and raised? Are you here this whole time?
I was born in Tulsa, Oklahoma, and then I moved to Edmond, Oklahoma, and then I came here.
How old were you when you got out of Oklahoma?
16, 17.
16. I know we send teams in there to rescue people out of Oklahoma. I didn't know if it was you or maybe one of those people.
No.
To Texas as soon as you could.
Can I tell the story real quick? So
it was a summer. It was the last summer?
Yeah, it was last summer.
Before sophomore year, I guess Yeah, it was before sophomore year. Carl and I, we were on Twitter, and there was a guy sent us a highlight video. Yeah, and I thought it was him. And I'm like, man, this kid is – but it was like a freshman highlight video. A lot of times you're like, oh, I'm not sure. And then Carl says, hey, did you get the highlight video of this kid named Tyree from Oklahoma? I was like, yeah, is he moving? He says, yeah, he's supposed to be a pretty good athlete. But he comes in, and when he first got there, I mean, you remember Tyree at practice. I mean, he didn't run hard. I think it's because he didn't know the plays, you know. But I'm like, man, this kid's going to have a hard time at Cedar Park if he doesn't pick it up. And so, I mean, we're in shorts. We never saw Tyree get after it. The minute the pads came on, man, he got to a whole other level. We're like, good gosh, man.
This dude,
so, yeah, so we were pretty far. Yeah, that's all right. That's all right. He was like, he wasn't about the shorts, man. So, but yeah, he came in for Oklahoma. I think it was last summer.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt, but I want to tell you that.
No.
I wanted to interject, too, and I think I came and met you on the sideline after your coming out game, per se, when you had a few carries last season, and I came and saw you on the sideline, and I was just like, dude, where are you from? Like, who are you?
Yeah.
And you told me you were a sophomore, moved in from Oklahoma, and I remember telling you, like, you have a place on this team because you run so violently. And you run so – you're so committed to the run following that those offensive linemen. So to see you get this opportunity as a junior, I mean, you're definitely flourishing in this opportunity, and I'm so proud of you for this – for what you've done so far, the hard work to get to this point.
I have to say, the reason I like – putting the punchlines on Oklahoma is I'm a Texas X, class of 83. So we just kind of do that. It's like in the blood. But I have to admit that one of the funniest things I ever saw, I have family that lives in Kansas. And once a year or more, we'd drive up I-35 through Oklahoma City into Kansas.
Yeah.
So every time we come back, we go, we're leaving Norman. You go over the Canadian River on I-35. The very first overpass, some county road going over the interstate there, somebody years ago had painted something on there. Now, the Highway Department of Oklahoma, for years, they'd paint every couple of years. They'd repaint the bridge of silver. They left this unpainted, this one middle part, for 20 years. In big red crimson letters, it said, Tuck Fexus.
Oh.
I thought that was hilarious. It was there for 20 years. I have to give them that. That was terrific. So, Tyree, tell me, what is your favorite carry so far as a Timberwolf?
Favorite carry?
When did it happen? What happened?
Honestly, I don't think it was a carry. I just think it's when I bullied some dude, and then he tried to get back up, and I just bullied him again. And it's just my favorite bully problem.
You just got to be careful where the referees are.
Yeah,
that's football, baby.
That's great. Now, we haven't talked about pass catching. You guys, do you like going out in the slot or swinging a wheel route out of the backfield or catching a pass now and then? Is that okay, or would you rather run the ball?
Yeah, I love doing that. It's pretty fun. I mean, I wouldn't say I'm the best, but it's pretty something I love doing. It's just, if the ball's coming toward me, I'm always ready for it.
Now, do you agree with Coach's assessment that you're the funniest running back?
Oh, yeah. I 100% agree.
What's your approach? What did you do that's funny and cracks people up?
It's got to be timing.
I don't know. Yeah,
it's got to be timing.
It's timing.
Situational stuff.
It's always never expected. It just happens.
Yeah, like you yell out, Tuck Fexus. So do you play any other sports? I forgot to ask Kevin that.
No, I don't play any sports.
How long have you played only football and stopped the other sports?
Since I was about 3.
Wow, you really are football only guy. Kevin, are you football only? When did you stop playing any other sports?
Track and field.
Yes, track and field. What event? Oh, shot put in.
That's right. I thought I remember that.
Yeah.
Actually, the only year you didn't go to, we had COVID, right? Yeah. This freshman year.
I'm sorry. Kevin, before I got here, Kevin, I heard about him, that he was in, went to the state track meet as a freshman. Was it shot put and disc or just shot?
Shot.
Shot his freshman year.
God.
His sophomore year, was that the COVID year? COVID year, so he didn't go. So last year, he also qualified for the state finals, and I was along with Nick. And the shot and disc was just shot in both. So I think he got fifth his freshman year, and last year you got fifth again last year. So he's one of the top throwers in the state, and does a phenomenal job. He's been on the national team if I'm not mistaken. I don't want to. I'll let Kevin tell you. He can probably tell you better than me.
Were you on a national track
team? I do summer AAU.
Wow.
And I've won the shot put since I was 8 for my age division.
Wow.
And I've won the discus 2 out of 4 times.
What's your bench press maximum?
Right now, I'm thinking around 315, 310, something like that.
Lord have mercy.
I was a defensive back in high school, and we had a coach who was this fire plug of a man. He was only like 5'6", but shoulder to shoulder was about like that, and chest to back was about like that, and arms was big around as fire hydrants. Big weight guy. And one time there was a guy who ended up going to the University of Houston as a tight end, pretty good player, who he thought was dogging it in the weight room. And this coach grabs him by the ear, walks him out. You could do that back then. Walks him out to the parking lot, sits him out there, and the coach gets on the ground and gets under and starts bench pressing the back end of a 67 Chevelle about 5 or 6 times.
Jeez.
I saw this. And I thought, oh, my God. I have no idea how much that weighed, but that was very intimidating. Woo. Let's give the mic back to Tyree.
talk about a
segue, yeah. Now, Tyree, you're only a junior, right?
Yes.
So another year to go.
Yeah.
Might inherit the starting job next year. Everything stays healthy and you continue to improve. You thinking already about post-high school, what you might do with yourself?
Honestly, I haven't really thought about it right now. I've just been playing football, working.
What's your favorite class?
Favorite class? Probably woodshop.
Woodshop?
Yeah.
Nice.
Your grades good?
Yeah, but they always could be better.
Yeah, that's true. Did your dad play in high school? How did you get your spark to excel at athletics?
For football, it was my brother. My brother really got me into it.
Because
I watched him play, and then I wanted to play, and I've just been playing ever since. And really, he's just been really, probably my day one, really, for football.
What kind of lessons do you think that a high school kid who, what were you, 16 maybe?
17.
About 17? What kind of lessons do you think that a high school kid can take out of being part of this kind of intense and focused group effort, teamwork, to achieve a major goal like this? What do you think you can take out of that to help you in the rest of life?
I think it make them a better person, really, just like getting up, going to practice, respecting your coaches, being a leader, really all that. It really just makes you a better person. Shows you how to really work.
All right, we're going to take another short break. That was Tyree Nicholson. We've talked to Kevin Adams and their coach, Lanny Williams. When we return, more nonstop honking of the Cedar Park football horn right here from Santa Catarina on Timberwolf Night in America. This is the Vype Live Network.
You know the Alzer family. They've been involved in Cedar Park sports for years, just as Alzer's Barbecue has been involved in Cedar Park cuisine for years. It's one-of-a-kind, authentic Texas barbecue. Brisket, turkey, chicken, lamb, terrific sides and sauces. It's sheer succulence. That's Alzer's Barbecue, next to the Shell Station on 1431, just east of Lakeline. Open Friday through Sunday, every weekend.
A premier real estate brokerage in Central Texas, Mungia Real Estate's innovative buy-sell process results in their listings selling faster than the Austin average. Their attention to clients sets Mungia apart from other brokerages. With creative marketing strategies, savvy negotiation skills, and a commitment to hard work and excellent customer service. Whether it's residential, single-family, multifamily, condos, commercial, or vacant land, Mungia Real Estate knows the Austin market and connects buyers with sellers every day. And they do it with professionalism. Mungia Real Estate at 512-922-4267 or mungiarealestate.com. That's M-U-N-G-I-A.
At WaFed Bank, formerly Washington Federal, working together isn't new for us. We've been awarded America's Best Big Bank by Newsweek. From digital options, touchless transactions, and increased nonprofit contributions to help our neighbors, we're here for you. Our bankers approved more than 9,000 PPP loans to keep small businesses going during the pandemic. WaFed Bank is a local bank and portfolio lender with more than 200 branches in 8 states to serve you. 24/7 online and mobile banking with mobile check deposit, over 32,000 ATMs, free check checking. WaFed Bank, your local bank for personal and business banking at wafedbank.com or 800-324-9375.
Army Ant Moving calls Cedar Park home for movers that residents and businesses can rely on. For outstanding moving expertise and trustworthy estimates, Army Ant Moving stands above the rest. Their reputation speaks for itself. They've received the Angie's List Superior Service Award for the last 2 years. Their movers are highly trained and experienced. So whether you need to move your household to a new home across town or an entire corporate office to a new location, your valuables are in knowledgeable and reliable hands with Army Ant Moving Company. Check them out at armyantmoving.com.
All right, welcome back. Episode 3, Timberwolf Night in America for 2021. I'm Brad Cohn via the T. He's Josh Willard. You're listening to TNIA live from Santa Catarina on the Vype Live Network. As we mentioned, Nick Gruyon, we had his name wrong before, but it is Gruyon, is here tonight as well. Not one of the featured guests, but he is here. And Nick, before you got here, I was going through some of the updates to the school record book from the last game, and your name came up a couple times. So I want to read these off to you and get your reaction. The 11 catches by Nick Gruyon, this is this week against Cedar Ridge, tied two other performances for third most ever in one game in Cedar Park history, behind only the 12 catches by Josh Cameron against Friendswood in 19, 14 by Carson Neal, which was also against Cedar Ridge, also in 19. Gruyon's 212 career receiving yards amassed in just two games is already the 45th most in Cedar Park history. Gruyon's 175 receiving yards was the sixth most ever in one game by a Cedar Park receiver. His 111 receiving yards in the second half alone is the fifth most in one half at Cedar Park ever. Nick, I have a feeling you're going to be climbing all these lists as the season goes on. What does it feel like to finally be out there showing your wares?
Wow, those numbers are impressive. Impressed myself. I didn't know I could, you know, I put up those numbers. We just really clicked that night, I guess, so.
Josh was putting it in your hands, and to your credit, you're pulling them in, sometimes up at odd angles, jumping, twisting, close to the sideline. You look like a veteran receiver is only your second game.
Yeah, I mean, we worked all summer throwing routes and stuff. We knew we had to step up this year, but it just clicked against Cedar Ridge, and I'm just happy it did then.
Well, all right. Just feel like you're definitely putting the end to the notion, because last year you played the whole season at defensive back. Is that correct?
That's
and
correct.
So you're putting the end to the notion that defensive backs don't have hands.
Can't catch the ball.
Because you've definitely transitioned into the senior year, into the offensive role, and filled the void. I'm not joking. Like, one, two, three top receivers for Cedar Park all time graduated and left. And there was a huge void, and so a lot of us were wondering who was going to step up, and you've definitely stepped up into that role and have great chemistry already right out of the gate with Pell.
Well, originally, I started out as a receiver.
Okay.
They moved me to defensive back. We needed a little bit more depth, and you know, I was happy to play defensive back last year and you know help the team out however I could. I'm just happy this year I have the option, you know, to go back and forth on where I want to play, but right now I think the team needs me at receiver.
Yeah, so. I think
absolutely.
Doing a great job there. Thanks, Nick Gruyon. We got his name right now.
Gruyon.
Here, not as a guest, the running back here tonight, but he just happened to be here in the audience, so we pulled him up here. All right, time for trivia a little bit. Now, as we continue to attack Josh here with three questions each Tuesday night that the National Education Agency says high school seniors should know.
Oh, gosh.
So, Nick, Kevin, Coach, you and me, we've been high
school. It's my 10-year anniversary this year, so it's been a while.
Here we go with tonight's three questions. He got one of three the first week, two of three last week now, total of three out of six. All right.
I hate these.
We're going to give you guys, you seniors, a chance to correct him if he's wrong, if you know. First question.
I just saw the first one.
First question, how many men have walked on the moon?
Oh, my gosh. Neil.
Neil.
Buzz.
You don't have to name them. How many guys?
I got two. Let's say four. No!
All right. Kevin, you're a senior. One of our guests tonight. Do you know how many men have walked on the moon?
You got the mic.
He does not. It's 12.
Oh, my gosh.
12. Six landings, two men on each ship. Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
All of it in a short time span, 69 to 72.
Yeah, that's wild.
All right, number two. What is the boiling point of water in both Fahrenheit and Celsius?
I remember this. Shout out to Cedar Park volleyball coach Almananza, who's gone on, done great things.
You learned this in volleyball?
Yes. They made a shirt. It's 212 degrees Fahrenheit.
Okay, what about Celsius?
Did you ask in Celsius?
Yeah, what, both of them.
Oh,
water,
come on.
Both Fahrenheit and Celsius.
No. I don't know how to do that, compute.
Nick's got it. 100 is correct. Oh. Celsius is centigrade. It's based on hundreds.
So it's a half.
You got a half a point.
That works.
All right.
I'll take that to the bank.
Final NEA question.
Hope my daughter's listening tonight.
What is the mathematical formula for calculating a circle?
Ooh. Is it pi r squared?
Yes, he's got it. Pi r squared.
Hey.
And again, National Education, she says all American high school seniors should know all of these facts. Okay.
I still got it.
Here's the real trivia time. We're going to play a brand new trivia game tonight with the running backs. It's called, and we'll let Nick join in too. It's called Josh Willard, Right or Wrong.
Oh, gosh.
I'm going to ask Josh some trivia questions about Cedar Park football. He'll answer. Then I'm going to ask our players to decide whether his answer is right or wrong. So there are several
Have
ways
faith.
Each question can be scored. If Josh gets it right, he gets a point. If he gets it wrong, no point. If the players correctly call whether he's right or wrong, they get a point. If they're wrong about that judgment, no point.
I got a mean poker face.
Each question,
I got
Josh,
a mean poker face.
You know, both could get 0 points. One side could get one while the other got none. Or both could get a point. There will be 9 questions. Okay, are we ready to go? All right, so, Josh, true or false? Over the years, Cedar Park has won more games away from home than they have at home.
False.
Guys, is that right or wrong?
I think it's right.
Think it's right?
It was the confidence. It was the confidence in my answer, Brad.
Over the years, Cedar Park has won more games on the road than they have, or away from home, than they have at home. And he says no. And they say that that is correct. Answer.
I swear if neutral sites get thrown into this and I answered too fast.
Huh? Yeah, any
oh,
game.
Oh, gosh.
Any game.
I'm already second-guessing myself, Coach.
Yeah. Actually, if you take it to the fullest logical extent, listen to my question. They have won more games away from home than they have at home. I didn't say as visitors. So, yeah, includes all those neutral sites. They have won of like 22 more games away from home than they have at home. So, no points for anybody on that one. All right. Second inning. Second question.
Okay.
True or
see,
false?
See, I lured you into that. I lured you in.
True or false? Against Vandegrift a week ago or more, 6 guys had their first career receptions. True or false?
Last week?
Yeah.
Against Vandegrift,
six guys had their first career receptions. True or false?
That's a false. Is it true?
Josh gets a point because it was 7 guys who had their first career receptions.
You see, I knew.
Running
I
back,
knew it was one
don't
more.
Don't get a point on that one. Going to the third inning, Josh leads 1-1.
Do we have names?
Yeah, I do, but I'd have to dig them up out of another file.
See, you can't even fact check it right.
I could email it to you. Let's see.
Love it. Whatever.
All right, next question. The 104 minutes and 12 seconds that Cedar Park went without holding a lead between the end of the state semifinal last year and Raylon Barr's 32-yard field goal with 3:28 to play in the first quarter against Cedar Ridge was the longest lead drought in program history. 104 minutes and 12 seconds was the longest we have ever gone without holding a lead in program history. Is that true or false?
That's going to be false. We're going to go ahead and fact-check that with 2012s. You know, first 2 games of the year.
You guys think he's right saying false? That we've had longer
gaps? I mean, are we doing like true calendar days? Are you wording things differently?
No, it's
okay, I thought you were going to like count the off season
it's
too.
Minutes on the clock, 104 minutes and 23 seconds.
Okay.
So you think he's right or wrong saying false? Think he's wrong? Who? Is it wrong or right?
You
got to agree.
You're trying to get points against me.
They think you're right. Let me uncover the answer here. Okay, the answer is it's true. Even though there have been streaks of three.
I did. I thought that was 2012.
We have had streaks of 3, 4, and 5 losses in the past, but the Timberwolves often held leads at some point in most all of those games. So, no point for Josh. Who said he was wrong?
Grouillon.
Running backs get a point.
Grouillon.
I said
Grouillon. I'm going to get that. I promise. I'm going to nail that for Friday night.
All right, question number 4. Since the 2006 season, every time Cedar Park has had a new coach take the helm for his first season, the team has won the state championship. Is that true or false?
False.
Since the 2006 season, every time Cedar Park has had a new coach take the helm for his first season, the team has won the state championship that season.
Okay, you see, I answer way too fast. So was Joe Willis, was he 2012?
Well, you got. I'm not going to give you hints.
No,
you
yes,
know. You
yes. He looked at the thing. Okay, so I am going to retract my answer and say
so
true.
That's true.
It is a true statement.
He is right. We won 2. It was the first year of Joe Willis, first year of Carl Abzek. Don't tell Michael
Thank you.
Quintero that. He feels enough pressure already.
That's right. That's right.
I would too.
Flags fly forever.
All right, let's see here. Let me get the point to learn. Josh gets a point. You guys said he was right, so you get a point.
Whew. Thank goodness it was before the buzzer.
Tied 2-2. Here's question number 5. In all their vast football playoff history, Cedar Park has only lost 1 state semifinal game. Is that true or false?
Has only lost 1 state semifinal game.
The last game before the state championship.
Right, right. I know, Brad, how the bracket works.
Okay.
I'm going to say that we have never lost a state semifinal game.
So you say this is a false statement. That
Correct.
We lost only 1.
I'm saying that's false.
Okay, is he right or wrong? So you're saying he's right. Is that true? You all agree with that? That you want to say he's right? You both get a point because that is true. We have never lost a state semifinal.
That feels
game.
So good. I just got to get it.
Which means
I got to run it up.
Every time we win a regional, we're in the state championship game. So we win the next game, too.
Got to get my prices right horn when I can.
Okay, next question, number 6. We're tied at 3 points each. The 2012 team that ended up winning the program's first state title started out the season 0-2. That second loss was at home to Abilene Cooper by a field goal on the last play of the game. Since that moment 9 years ago, this week, Cedar Park has only lost 3 home games.
Oh.
Is that true or false?
I know that Cedar Park 2011 team lost at home to Lake Travis at the Gup.
Yeah.
In that one, being 2 losses, we're 62-4, so that's false.
Oh, good logic. What do you think? Does he get the logic right?
It's pretty dang solid.
They agree that you're correct, and you are correct.
Yeah.
We've lost 4, not 3. 62-4 is our record.
I paid attention to those pregame stats.
Right. All right, next question, number 7. 3 questions to go. We're 2/3 of the way through. 28 times over the years, a Cedar Park running back has rushed for 200 yards or more in 1 game. 28 times. 9 of those times, that running back was Quentin Smith.
Mm.
3 of those times, it was his brother Tyler. But only 1 player has ever rushed for over 300 yards in a game for Cedar Park, and that was Brian Hogan. True or false?
Oh, that's my QB1.
Yeah, you should know this one.
And I'm telling you, like, our offensive line was like 6'5". It didn't matter. You could put Brad Cohn back there. He could get 250 and 3 touchdowns.
3 guys played Division I college football.
Our backup tackle got a D1 scholarship off of JV film.
That's right.
So let's go ahead and go with not my QB1. That's false.
Not Brian Hogan. Is he right? Was it somebody else
with that
who had the
line,
highest?
I believe so.
What about the guy who's
at SMU
right now?
Ooh, Bam Bam. Bam Bam. See, I wouldn't think him. I would think Thomas Hutchings.
Was
Thomas
Hutchings. So.
a little bit of Hutch.
Saying it wasn't Hogan.
I don't think it was Hogan.
Doesn't matter who it is if it wasn't Hogan, because you just either got to agree that with him that it wasn't Hogan.
It wasn't.
It was not. Love that boy. He's 5'8", 150 pounds, soaking wet. It was amazing what he could do with the football.
You're saying it wasn't Hogan, right?
It was not.
Is he right?
My QB1, Brian Hogan.
You're right. It wasn't Brian Hogan. He had 299 against LBJ in that 70-20 playoff win.
That was actually when I dislocated my shoulder from doing a chest pump coming out of halftime.
But almost exactly right 2 years to the day before that right in Houston against Cy Creek, Dedrick McKnight ran for 301. And I remember one of those was like a 70-yard touchdown run up the right sideline and seeing the Arizona Diamondbacks starting shortstop Orlando Hudson and New York Yankees starting pitcher CC Sabathia running along with them that entire time. They were guests on the sideline for us.
Adam Dunn as well.
Adam Dunn as well led the National League in home runs at that moment. We had some pretty high-dollar fans of the Timberwolves back in those days. So you're both right. Josh leads. No, it's tied 5-5 with two questions to go.
Give me some good ones.
Wow. Question number 8. 16 times over the years, a Cedar Park player has rushed for 1,000 yards or more in one season. Quentin Smith did it 3 times. Brian Hogan, Tyler Smith, Tyler Levine, and Rupert Edwards all did it twice. 6 other guys did it once. But the last time any Cedar Park player had a 1,000-yard rushing season was 2016. True or false?
Did you get that last year? You were so close. I'm going to say false. I feel like Cade had 1,000.
I don't think Cade had 1,000.
God, that was so close.
So, you saying true or false?
I'm saying false.
False. True. Wait, true what?
You all want to say
they're going against the grain.
That means you want to disagree with him, right? They're right. It's
true. How much did Cade have last season? We need to look at that.
Tyler Levine.
I thought you for sure had that, too.
Levine.
You were close.
Tyler Levine had 1,265 in 16. He now starts for SMU. In 17, Will Lipscomb led the team with 620. In 18, Stockwell led with 672. In 19, Ryder Hernandez led with 421.
Oh.
And in 20, Kevin Adams led with 676. We've not had a 1,000-yard rusher since 2016. So you guys, here's your opportunity to get that going again.
This is the group that can do it.
All right. True or false, last – oh, wait, let's get the points in. They got a point.
Are they leading?
And they're leading.
All right.
Josh needs to score here.
It's all about the poker face on this one.
Here's the deal. All we got to do is agree with him.
Yeah, just agree with –
that's
a
true fact.
Just agree with me.
That's a true fact.
Just agree with me.
Agree whatever he says.
Hey, I'm a good salesman.
All right, here it is. 3 guys have rushed for over 3,000 career yards at Cedar Park. True or false?
False.
False? Are you going to agree with him?
Disagree.
I agree with him.
Agree is false? You're both wrong. It is 3.
Dang
Rupert
it.
Edwards from 02 to 04 at 3,356. Brian Hogan, 09 to 11, 3,934.
That's a quarterback. That's a quarterback.
And Quentin Smith, 99 to 01, 4,445.
That's unbelievable.
So the final score, you guys matched his, right? So
gave it to him. I gave them the victory.
Final score 6-5 running backs.
Okay, we'll see.
Good one. Fun one. All right.
That was fun.
Fun one.
I don't like your games targeted at how I answer things.
A speeding ticket in Cedar Park is $129 if you're 50 miles over the speed limit. True or false?
Gosh. Don't ask me those.
Okay, time to preview Round Rock. We're going to cede most of this to Coach Williams after I give a little background. For 8 years, spanning our time in 6A from the 02 season through 09, Round Rock was in our district. We had a 5-3 record against them, but I recall that 2 of those 3 losses were absolute flukes. They finished well below us in the district standings those 2 years. They somehow managed to beat us. So it's been 12 years since we last played them. That means all your school career in public schools we haven't played them. 12 years. And that was in Josh's junior year of 2009, the last time we played him. That game was at Dragoon Stadium, 55-45 shootout, 100 points, in a season that saw us grab our last 6A district title. Nathan Thornhill set what at the time was a single-game total offensive yardage record, running for 190 and 2 scores, throwing for 141 and 3 more scores, all of them to Dylan Cox.
Heyo.
331 total yards, 5 total touchdowns for Thornhill, that record-setting night.
All-time assist leader at West Point.
Looks very strong, even having lost one of the top quarterbacks in Central Texas from last year in Ford. They are 2-0 and have absolutely crapped on two decent teams. 69-17 over Waco Midway, 35-0 over Belton. Both of these are 6A teams that will likely make the playoffs and even vie for their district crowns. The Dragons have been picked to finish second in 25-6A behind Vandy, just ahead of Cedar Ridge. It's another tough 6A opponent against which we'll have to bring our A-plus game to win. So, Coach, from your perspective, what you've seen and what the running backs would be needing to do, what are the keys going to be Friday night? Let's turn him up a little.
Slowing down their defensive line. They're very good up front. We've watched film on them. The linebackers are very good. Winning the line of scrimmage. I think we can do that. Quick game. Oh, I shouldn't say that.
A tempo game, is that what you're meaning?
Getting the ball to Nick fast.
I vote for that.
Got that quick shot down the sideline.
I don't know if the deep passes are going to be the key to that early in the ball game. I think we're going to have to get them moving laterally when it comes to stuff like that.
He's proven he can run with the ball after the catch. That's for sure. Yeah. I'm pointing over there, and he's there now.
So I think that if we can, if our line can hold up, get a vertical push, control the line of scrimmage, I think we can do well when it comes to that. If we don't, it's going to be a long night for the Timberwolves. But I know that our guys are up for the challenge.
You know, we have a tradition of scheduling not just 6A teams for all of our non-district games. It's been going on for 10 or 12 years. But good 6A teams. You know, it's not Aikens that we're playing, you know. Although I think they're doing pretty good this year. Bad example. It's not Del Valle that we're playing.
Right.
But I love that. You agree with lifting tough weights making you tougher?
I do. I believe in it. As a coach, you believe in it. The kids have to believe in it also. And that's kind of where it sits. It's one thing to schedule a 6A team, a good 6A team, and play them. It's another thing to schedule them and knowing that you have an opportunity to win a ball game, which I think, you know, Cedar Park football has done a great job of just scheduling teams. And our guys, I've never seen them turn down anyone in the 3 years that I've been here when we played someone of that caliber. So I know that our kids will be up for it. It's just going to be a matter of just execution on our end and doing well. They're a very, very talented football team. Some super, they're going to look the part. But I felt like last week Cedar Ridge looked the part on all levels, and on all of our levels we pretty much gave them fits. So we were pretty excited about that.
You know, in the last 10 years, we have only played two non-district games against 5A teams. And that was in 2014 and 2015. At Baylor, we played Aledo, the number one ranked defending state champ, both times. So there's the kind of 5A team
right,
we want to play.
Right, right. And I just think that's a challenge within itself. And it's a standard that I think Cedar Park football has set. Not only just football, but all of Cedar Park athletics. I don't think any teams, whether it's volleyball, girls basketball, boys basketball, shy away from that competition there.
Baseball.
Right.
I love the way you're scheduling, too.
Yeah.
All right, Josh, any final remarks before we shut it down and get out of here?
Excited to get this one going again at the GUP. To finish out non-district, it's going to be the last dress rehearsal to really get things right before we make a good district push to solidify our playoff spot going into this next season or to this next playoff race, per se. So the target is on Cedar Park's back. Like you said, this is rekindling a new rivalry. Back when I played at Cedar Park, the original 5A district, it was Pflugerville-Leander, Round Rock, Stony Point, Westwood, McNeil, a lot of the juggernauts that you would say in this area. And so I know Round Rock is chomping at the bit to take the best shot that they can at the 5A state runner-up in Cedar Park. And best believe, when they lace them up, they're going to come at you full force. But just trust the process. Trust what these coaches are implementing. Only control what you can control, and you are going to be in the best position to win. And that's the Cedar Park system. And so don't worry about who's across from you. Trust me, we've played a lot of teams. When they get off the bus, they look the part. But trust me, Cedar Park football, we just stick to what we know, and good things come our way.
All right, once again, the Booster Club sponsors for 2021 Toyota of Cedar Park, HEB, Rudy's Barbecue, Mungia Real Estate, Army Ant Moving, our touchdown sponsor, TJ Lewis Real Estate, Alzer's Barbecue, Wofford Bank, and this here Santa Catarina Mexican Restaurant. That's it for our third episode of Timberwolf Night in America for the 2021 season. Friday night's the final non-district game of the season as the T-Wolves take on another tough 6A opponent, the Round Rock Dragons. 18-game home winning streak is on the line. Kickoff, 7 o'clock at the Gup. Our pregame show, 6:45. Josh will have play-by-play. Cecil with technical production and commentary. Nathan Boschel on the camera. I'll come on at halftime and after the game with stats and stuff. But during the action, I'm stadium voice. Timberwolves working on an 18-game home winning streak extends back the early part of 2018. Our thanks to our guests tonight, the running backs and their coach, Lanny Williams. For our QA, Josh Cargyle. For my own personal, Chris Collinsworth, Josh Willard. This is Brad Cohn signing off. You've been listening to Timberwolf Night in America on the Vype Live Network.